saying Carson Wentz?
Oh, no. He does look like Prince Harry.
Twitter had a field day with that one.
No, he's always looked like
Prince Harry. You think he was going for that look or just accidental?
Well, no, the red hair and the beard and the face.
I get that part, but the clothes, too?
Oh, I'm not
sure. The fake British accent that we didn't get to in that part of the press conference? Yeah, that was a coincidence.
I wanted to see him fake that part about the being married to the sister part. That's a get that part, Carson Wentz. That's all right.
Oh, boy.
I like Harry. He's one of my favorites.
Coach, how impressive was Carson Wentz?
Our community got richer. Which is an inherited part of the empire.
How impressive was Carson Wentz, Coach?
In that win against the Jaguars.
There's a lot going on this morning.
Mm-hmm.
How impressed was he? I thought that the thing that I liked the most, the plays that he can make off script, where he can get out of the pocket, he can extend plays, that to me is a real strength. Now, the problem is he gets hit too much. He constantly is getting hit. So you got the four sacks. We talked about this last year before he got hurt. He was getting hit at a pretty significant pace the previous season, but you've got four sacks. He's taking hits that he shouldn't take. I don't know how long he's going to be able to do what he does and not end up on injured reserve again.
See, what quarterbacks are built to take that type of punishment?
Cam Newton.
And that's the list.
Yeah.
Right? Cam Newton, who this week was by multiple people compared to a dinosaur in a good way, is the only quarterback I've seen that you can year over year expect to take punishment and not really worry about him sustaining some significant long-term injury. But he's also the biggest guy to ever play the position. And just Cam Newton was in a horrific car accident with the car flipped over and he was just sitting on the side of the road smiling after. Like, he might just be different than most other even elite athlete human beings. That is a totally warranted concern by you for Carson Wentz and the Eagles, because he doesn't, much like Andrew Luck, I haven't seen examples he can play a different way. Like Luck, it's been 7 years. Wentz, I know it's much smaller sample, but even coming off the injury, he seems like, I'm going to play this way. And some of his best plays are plays where he's getting hit, shaking off a hit, and throwing downfield. But it would worry you as an Eagles fan.
And he makes some incredible throws, and you're excited about him. And the announcers in the game will talk about his toughness and what a great play it was. But it's just not sustainable, and it's not worth it. They need him for the long haul, and we talk about this every year, about guys learning how to get down, guys learning how to play it the right way, and he's not there yet.
Well, the reason why he's not there, too, is the subpar play of that offensive line. Jason Peters, left tackle, he is not an elite player anymore. Lance Johnson, he got hurt, he's out the game. He has not had an all-pro or a Pro Bowl-type season. So last year in the playoffs, why do I like the Eagles? Man, they got better big people than you. Not so much anymore. That offensive line, if you're going to start criticizing the Eagles, you need to start with that offensive line. Now, I do like the fact that yesterday, Josh Adams, they gave him the touches to get that running game going. So can they be consistent in that running game? Because that offensive line, I believe, needs some help to be able to protect Carson. And I believe that running game will be able to provide that. But if you let your quarterback continue to get hit, I don't care who they are, Steve Young, Troy Aikman, Joe Montana, all of them, ultimately, they all got broken in half. So I don't want that for Carson Wentz. I believe they have to change some things of how they're doing it up front.
And I'm glad you mentioned the running game, because I know we're probably going to get to the Jaguars side of things. But on this was setting up to potentially be another devastating loss for Philadelphia. They're up 17-6. Jags chip away, chip away, chip away. All of a sudden, it's a six-point game, and the Eagles have the ball, needing to ice it with multiple first downs. And they were able to run the ball with Josh Adams and Smallwood, I think got a couple carries, down the Jags' throat to keep the ball out of Blake Bortles' hands. And we can poke fun at Blake Bortles, but any starting quarterback in the league has the ability to drive his team down the field to score the game-winning touchdown, which is what the Jags would have been in position to do. The Eagles didn't let them get the ball back. That was critical. Josh Adams could be a big part of that.
It goes to what you said last week. This Eagles team just has an identity problem. They don't know exactly who they are. They're not the same team they were last year. Their big guys aren't nearly as big or as productive. Their personnel doesn't seem to be. Carson Wentz coming back from injury. The defense is more porous than they were last year. It seems like until they figure out who they are, they're incapable of being consistent week in and week out.
Well, it's hard. And when you come off winning the Super Bowl, it's really hard to go into the next season get past that win, get past who you were, and really focus on who you are now. And there's such high expectations when you go in. When things go wrong, it's like the sky is falling. But that's not the case. That's not the case at all. You just have to identify the things that you do well. You've got to be comfortable with where you are as a team, and you put all that other stuff in the past. And I felt like Carson Wentz was pressing this game because of what happened last game, mm-hmm. because of what happened the game before, and you don't want that either. Just play the way that the plan is designed, and that's going to be good enough. He's good enough to win games. Without having to press the way he does.
And let's not forget last year, Coach, that they did make the move and get Jay Ajayi before the trade deadline expired to give them a little boost as far as their running game. Now, will they do something this week leading up to give them a little boost to be able to come down the stretch? But you can't be pleased if you're a Philadelphia fan, if you're a fan of football. When you watched both those teams yesterday, I tried to make a case in my head, Coach, of, oh, Philadelphia, this is going to be a good playoff team. Oh, Jacksonville, but most of the game, I was playing tricks on my own self, Coach, because they didn't look like a playoff team, being the Eagles or the Jags. And being 4-4, you can't be happy after being defending world champs.
It was a critical win for Philadelphia, but here's the reality. With Washington getting another one, with Adrian Peterson dipping into the fountain of youth and playing excellent football, and then being 5-2.
Yeah, he's drinking out of the water hose.
And being 5-2, and the Washington having, as far as what their opponent's win percentage is this year, the easiest remaining schedule of any team in the league, they're going to get to 10 wins. So Philadelphia has to find a way to go 6-2 down the stretch. Like, that's the minimum for them to be able to forget repeating as champions, get back into the postseason. They have the bye this week. They get to come off a good win, but they have to be able to go 6-2 down the stretch. Now, they get Washington twice, which could play in their favor, but they got tough games at Washington, at New Orleans. I think they still play the Rams. Like, they don't have a very easy schedule the rest of the way, and they haven't played great football.
Before we let you go, Coach, talk about the Jaguars. Talk about a team that did not meet expectations for this year. They've lost 4 in a row. Where do you see them right now, putting this back together?
Well, when you look at it, there's a fight in the locker room last weekend, or a reported fight in the locker room last weekend. You had the issues that you had this weekend on the road where there's a bar, you know, a
tell
fight
him,
in
Coach,
a bar.
I told you so. Tell him, Coach. You told him this was going to happen.
I'm going to let you say that. But it's when you have those issues and you've got to fight through those issues before you're even getting to dealing with the opponent, it makes it really hard to win with any kind of consistency.
I understand they get to London early because it's an international game. I also understand that even though the game was early morning in the States, it was not an early morning game out in London. But how would you feel as the coach? Forget even the fact that there was the dispute with the bouncers over the bar tab. Guys, the players say they thought the drinks were free. The club says the drinks were not free. In fact, it was about 54,000 euros.
Did they win the Super Bowl?
Well, 64,000
on a weeknight?
Well, that's my...
What are they drinking?
It was about bottles of champagne, Coach. I'll show you sometime. But my question is, forget the dispute. Let's say the bill was paid. How would you have felt with 8, 9, 10 of your guys out that close to a game on a road trip?
Yeah, I'm not fired up at whether it's a road trip, whether it's a home trip.
It don't matter.
It doesn't matter where they did it.
Friday night is your sleep night. You are not going to sleep good the night before the game. Man, they trained us this at Ohio State. First night, listen, 2 nights before the game is your sleep night. That is not the night to be drinking $64,000 worth of liquor. I mean, like.
And get into a fight. Like, I mean, you just layer.
Yeah, that's.
You layer.
Coach, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Much appreciated. Got to take a break. Come